Good morning, MCCBR.
Good morning.
We want to welcome everyone here with us this morning. If it's your first time, we're glad that you came to worship with us. Before we start our opening songs, one of our very own, Miss Fran, is her birthday today. We want to wish her a happy birthday and give her a round of applause. And please rise as you're able and join us in our opening song.
To you, and let your glory
Amen. Do we mean that this morning? Do we want the Lord to fill not only this place, but this place? Would you pray and praise with me? God, thank you for your spirit up in this house today. Thank you that the power really is back on here today. The power of the Holy Ghost is still powerful in this place today, not just in this room, but in each one of us. And God, we thank you for the witness of your spirit here today. We praise you, Lord, today for all that you have done for us and all that you are to us. And we just thank you for bringing us through a rough and tumbling week. But God, here we are, and here you are. And thank you, God, that every time we show up, you're already there. God, we just thank you for your power and your presence in this place today. We give you praise and glory for all that has been said, all that's been done. All that you are. In the name of Jesus our Christ. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Before you're seated, turn to someone and say, I think the power's on in you.
Our scripture reading comes from the book of Acts, chapter 1, verses 4 through 8. And while being in their company and eating with them, Jesus commanded the disciples not to leave Jerusalem, but to wait for what the sovereign had promised, of which he said, "You have heard me speak. For John baptized with water, but not many days from now you shall be baptized with the Holy Spirit." So when they were assembled, they asked him, "Lord, is this the time when you will reestablish the kingdom and restore it to Israel?" He said to them, "It is not for you to know what time brings or fixed years and seasons which the sovereign has appointed by God's own choice and authority and personal power. But you shall receive power, ability, efficiency, and might when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you shall be my witness in Jerusalem and Judea and Samaria and to the very bounds of the earth." Hear what the Spirit says today.
Thanks be to God.
If you'll notice, I didn't get to be here last Sunday and preach, so I have twice as many sticky notes today as I usually do. No, I'm not going to do that to you. I did miss being with you last Sunday. I would have certainly rather been here. I was not well. And those that have been around for a while know that the third week that I was here, 5.5 years ago, when I first moved here, the third week I was here, I lost my voice. And I was without my voice. I was staying with Todd. He had opened up his home for me to stay temporarily until I found a house. And for 2 weeks, I was almost bedridden, hardly had any voice, and very congested. And at least once a year, I get it. And so for some reason, it didn't come in January or February this year. It came in the summer. Figure that one out. But just out of the blue, I didn't have a voice. But I am so glad to be back with you today. And today marks this is Labor Day weekend, so officially the summer sort of is over, at least what we culturally consider summer. And so this is the end of our summer sermon series. And the summer sermon series has been this: same story, different day, new news. And I will tell you, I've enjoyed this because I don't think any of them I've used exactly the same notes of any sermon. I've gone back and looked at some sermons that I had preached from or some scriptures that I had preached from before. And when I've gone back, it's been almost a totally different sermon from the same scripture. So let's see if we want to do that today. You notice that the reading today is a reading that you would ordinarily have in the season of Pentecost. Because it's about the Holy Spirit coming. And it's what Jesus told the disciples not long before he was ascended into heaven. And then he told them what he was going to do. In fact, he tells the disciples, "I need for you to go over to Jerusalem." Wants them to go to the next town over. "I want you to go over there, and there's a place already prepared for you. So I want you to go up there," and it's what we call... By the way, how many of you came from Pentecostal backgrounds? Okay. And how many of you came from where they preached a lot from the scriptures? These would be non-Catholics, mostly. And when I say that, I don't mean that the Catholics don't use the scriptures. That's not what I mean. What I mean is that they don't put as much emphasis on you knowing and bringing your Bible and that kind of stuff. Some of us grew up in churches, especially fundamental churches, where you were supposed to bring, this was your sword, because you were going off to war. Bring that sword with you when you come to church. I don't know. Maybe it was so to make sure the preacher read it right. I'm not sure, or something, but whatever. You were supposed to have it with you and make notes in the margins and all that kind of stuff. Yes. Some of you got that. And I'm always amazed when I see the TV preachers and they put the camera on the audience, different people out there, and who's got their Bible and who's taking notes and all that kind of stuff. But the reason I asked that is because I wanted to know how familiar some of you are with what Jesus is saying to these disciples. I want you to go over there. There's a room prepared for you, and it's the upper room. In other words, it's on the second floor. So I want you to go up to the second floor, and there's a room over there, and I want you to go over there, and I want you to wait. I want you to wait. Because I'm going to send you a comforter. In my absence, I'm going to send somebody to take my place. And when the Holy Spirit comes, it will come in like a mighty rushing wind. In other words, Jesus is telling these people he was the weather channel for what was about to happen. This is like week before last to us. When we were told by the people on the weather channel that we needed to start preparing. Now, I just wanted to put this in perspective of what Jesus was really telling them, because it's something we can all identify with. He says, I want you to go over there, and I'm going to tell you it's going to happen over there. Of course, here's the difference. Jesus was telling them to go towards the storm instead of away from it. Jesus said, I want you to go over there to a certain place and be ready. And I didn't have him read all of that today, but if you go back and read the first couple of chapters of Acts, you find out that Jesus is telling the disciples, I want you to go over there, and I want you to wait for this promise. And this is the promise. The promise is, I have somebody, a comforter, the Holy Spirit, that's going to meet you over there to take my place. And while this is human flesh and will not always be able to be with you, because what one of us is ever going to be forever? In this body, none of us. Jesus says, so I'm going to be leaving you, but after I leave, I'm giving you somebody in my place to comfort you, first of all, and then to stay with you from then on. But you got to go over there and you got to wait. You got to wait it out. You got to go up there in the place that's been prepared for you, and you've actually got to stay there in order to reap the benefit. If you leave, you won't get it. You got to be there to get it. You got to be paying attention when it shows up. Now, I'm going to tell you in the last week, we know what that preparedness means. I'm going to tell you, for some of us who had gone out and set and filled up gas in our vehicles, and had to sit 30 minutes to an hour to get gas, or some of us that went to the grocery stores and fought with 100 other people over the last 3 loaves of bread. Well, I shouldn't say fought. I kind of chuckled the last time I was there and watching some of the people and the things that they were saying. Just listening to some of the things they were saying. There were like, the last time I went to the store, there were like 5 loaves of bread, literally 5 loaves on a whole aisle. And there was a lady walking up and down the aisle, and they weren't 5 loaves right together. They were strewn, you know, they were all up and down the aisle. And the aisle was full of people, and I kept watching this one woman, and she kept running back and forth, looking at each loaf. Well, I just have to have some wheat bread. Where is the wheat bread? There's no wheat bread up here. And I'm just kind of giggling. Like, you do know there's a storm coming, right? You do understand that this is not the usual, right? that something's up. But she seemed to be oblivious to that. She couldn't figure out why in the world they didn't have her particular brand of bread. I thought, well, maybe you should just try something new. If what you have is not working, maybe it's time to try something new. Anybody get a sermon out of that one? She might like it. And it might be better for her. Who knows? Jesus tells them to go to this certain place and wait for the event to happen. And they were sort of familiar with what was going to happen, but it was also something a little bit different than they had ever experienced too. You say, well, wasn't that when the Holy Spirit was given? Yes, but you know, Jesus had healed people. And that's through the power of the Holy Spirit that was living in him already. Jesus had raised people from the dead. That was through the power of the Holy Spirit that was already living in him, you see. Jesus had turned water into wine for a big old wedding party, for a big old wedding reception. They had seen Jesus walk on the water. All of that kind of stuff was done with the power of the Holy Spirit that was already in him. So they were familiar with what the results of the power of the Holy Spirit could do, but they had never quite experienced it the way Jesus had for themselves. And Jesus says, you're going to be able to do the things you've seen me do and more, but you got to go over there and wait for it to happen. And you got to pay attention. You got to stay focused. Stay, as we used to say, you got to stay in one mind and one accord. And what would happen? You would receive power. Now, the Greek word for that is dunamis, and it means force, miraculous power, ability, abundance, meaning, might, efficiency, strength. It is the same word that we get our word dynamite from. It's that kind of violent power that is coming your way to be inside of you. And did it come? For those of us who know the rest of the story, Acts 2, chapter 1, verse 1 says, and when the day of Pentecost had fully come, they were all assembled together in one place. They followed directions well. When suddenly there came a sound from heaven like the rushing of a violent tempest blast, and it filled the whole house that they were sitting. And there appeared to them tongues resembling fire, which were separated and distributed, and which settled on each one of them, and they were all filled, diffused throughout their souls with the Holy Spirit, and began to speak in other different foreign languages or tongues, as the Spirit kept giving them clear and loud expression in each tongue in appropriate words. It came. It happened just like Jesus said it was going to happen. Now this week, the week before last and the first of this week, we were told Hurricane Isaac is coming. You need to get prepared. If you want to leave town, there's a window of opportunity for you to go. Because you know there comes a time when you really can't leave. There is a point of no return, isn't there? When you get to that point, then you're just kind of stuck. You're just there. Well, some people chose to stay, and some people chose to leave. And I've tried to be in touch with as many people as possible. And if I didn't reach you personally, I had reached around as far as I could and said, have you heard from? Have you heard from? Does anybody know of anyone that's having troubles that we need to support? And I thought of one of the young men that used to be a member. I don't know if he still is or not, but used to be a member of the New Orleans MCC. And he and his partner had decided to wait out the storm and stay there. They couldn't decide, leave, stay. And finally they decided, no, we're going to stay, we're going to ride it out, we've got a second floor, we'll just go up to the second floor if water comes in and blah, blah, blah. But all through the storm, all through Tuesday and Wednesday and Thursday, every time they lost power relatively early, but he still could get on Facebook through his phone, and he would post little notes, and he would post notes about how the situation was changing. Water started coming in on the first floor. He was not happy. Water started coming, they lost power. Then the next thing that happened, he said, water is coming out of the plugs. And the last thing he tweeted was this: why did we stay here? Now, he's quite young, but I have a feeling he learned a lesson. That the next one that comes through, I suspect he'll go to somewhere else. Now, the good news is that even though he still, as far as I know, does not have power this morning, they are safe, and the water has stopped coming in the house, and they'll figure out what's going on. And several other people had said, we're here for you, we're going to make sure you're okay, and we'll go over and take a look at that as soon as we're able to get in the street. So they're going to be okay. I don't know what you did, but I prepared as best I could. Many people around here lost power. The church lost power. In fact, we didn't have power until Friday night. You noticed your e-news didn't come until probably yesterday or Friday night, because I wasn't sure we were going to have power, and there wasn't any point in us having potluck if we didn't have power. And, you know, it was one of those last-minute kind of things. But power came back on Friday night, thank goodness, and so we got started. We were expecting any moment to receive power back. If you lost power, I suspect you had one focus: getting power back. It is amazing to me that no matter how much you prepare, I had flashlights and candles, I had books to read, but once it's all out and your neighborhood is dark, it's a strange feeling. It is a very strange, and I had plenty to do, and I had plenty of light, but it's knowing what you can't do that's the aggravating thing. Even if you don't want to do it right then, just knowing you can't. Just knowing this would not be the best time for me to get out and drive down the road. This would not be the best time for me to take the dog for a walk around the neighborhood. This would not be the best time for me to do all sorts of things that I'd really like to. And I can't even turn on the radio. I can't even turn on something to make noise around here unless you have something battery operated to do that. It's so aggravating. And what was the question that most of us started asking each other when we checked into Facebook? Do you have power? Is the power out at your house? When people started checking in with me, the first thing they would say is if they had or didn't have power, and if so, if they had lost it, how long they had been without it. We know that kind of stuff. We can get real focused, can't we? We can get in one mind and one accord. And even those people that still had power were waiting any moment for it to leave. Mine flashed about 5 times before it finally left. And once it was gone, I was like, well, that one was it. I know that one was it. And I waited and waited. The good news is that there are things that we can do when the power comes out. And hopefully you had done more than just prepare by going and getting some dry, stale food to keep in your, non-perishable foods and fruits and stuff right before the storm. But also checking in with your neighbors and making sure they had enough, and making sure that if you knew who was around you, so you could check on people through the storm in case it got even a lot worse than what it did get. I fellowshiped with my neighbors. In fact, I talked to some neighbors more than I've talked in a long time. When it got dark and I didn't have power, I lit some candles and Miss Maddie and I had church. You know, I have a piano in my house, so I played the piano and I tried to get Maddie to sing. She wouldn't sing. She just looked at me, though. She was with me. She was like, I don't know what's going on around here, but go ahead. And so we had church. And I thanked God while I was sitting on that piano stool that it wasn't worse. The storm outside wasn't worse than what it was. And I prayed for those who were getting a lot worse than what I was experiencing. I want to tell you something. When the power did come back on, there was much rejoicing at the Mozingo household. The first thing I did after the power came back on was go outside and see what kind of damage may have been. After the storm was over, I had to go outside and see if there was any damage anywhere around me, not just in my yard, but up and down the neighborhood. Because you see, when a wind comes of hurricane force or tornadic force, it changes the way things were and puts them into a new place. Did you hear that? When that kind of powerful wind comes, it changes the way things were and makes them into something new. And on the day of Pentecost, when the wind blew into that room, it changed the way they were and left them different forever. It was never going to be the same again for any of those people in that room. In fact, if you know the story, they were started rejoicing and carrying on, and they were speaking in all these different languages, and they were obviously up like people were a while ago, kind of dancing around, and danced right on out the door and into the streets. People thought they were drunk. People thought they were drunk because they were carrying on like drunk people. And I'm assuming from the description in there, they weren't bad drunk people. They were fun drunk people. You know, the kinds that do get out and dance in the streets and take their, those people. That's exactly the way it sounds like it was happening that day. When the Spirit finally did come, when the power came on in the upper room. Now, those of you that came up in Pentecostal churches like I did, you probably know what I'm about to say. And you're going to know it's the truth, whether we like to admit it or not. But I didn't really want to admit it until years after I'd even left the Church of God. We didn't think we had actually had church until in worship, like we are assembled here right now in worship, we reenacted the day of Pentecost. If people didn't shout and speak in tongues, if they weren't acting like drunk people and running around and waving and dancing, we really hadn't had church. It was just an okay service. Is that right? It is the truth. We reenacted the day of Pentecost, and child, on every song, if they didn't, you know, you were ready to dance at any moment. You were ready to wave. You were ready to jump. You were ready to do all sorts of things at any moment. And if that kind of spirit did not move you, and I'm going to tell you, there have been a few people that I wondered if there was any spirit, even though they were moving. They were trying awfully hard to get the Spirit to move. But the deal was, it was about the energy that brought in there. And it was somehow different when it was among a lot of people instead of just when that same Spirit moved you when you had your own personal devotions at home. And while that may happen, The Spirit can show up anytime, any place. Lord knows we've had church in a few restaurants. We've had church in a few gas stations. We've had church in the shower and driving down the road. But I'm going to tell you what, there was something major powerful when we would be all together and this energy would just be all over the room. And everybody, again, was in one mind and one accord. Everybody wanted a piece of that energy. I want some of that. I want some of that. I want some of that. It was all about laying down the week's burdens and getting the energy to go out into this. And Lord, we had the hymns to describe this old, sinful, dreadful world. This horrible place that I have to go outside the doors of this church to. It was just the worst place in the world. How we could even breathe the air and make it another week. I don't know how we did it. There were songs like, "I'm not staying in this world. I'm just passing through."
That's right.
That's right. "I'm homesick for my real home, heaven. Never been this homesick before." That's right. Just, oh my goodness, we could sing all those old songs. And then one day, I found Metropolitan Community Church, a church that has a three-prong mission. One that says we have a personal experience with God. Two, in that we build community with one another, like assembling ourselves here today. And three, that we're not just about, it's not all about me, feed me, feed me, feed me, but it's about serving others. It's about social justice. It's about speaking up and acting up beyond the doors of this church. And I'm going to tell you something. While I appreciate my heritage to a degree, while I appreciate the Church of God for showing me that I can have a relationship with God, not only through accepting Jesus as the Christ, but also through having an experience of the baptism of the Holy Spirit and speaking in tongues and dancing and shouting and the gifts of the Spirit that are innumerable. Not only all of that stuff that I'm glad that's still alive and well in me today. Hello? Still here today. Never lost it. Never lost that power. But they were so charged with coming in and receiving. They never really taught us how to go out and give it. They taught us how to have real church and really good church and powerful church and energy church. But they didn't teach us how to be church. They really didn't. They really failed in that. Yeah, they told us to go door to door witnessing, go talk to strangers and try to shove Jesus down their throats. Really, that's what it amounted to. It really did. And I don't mean to be judgmental or rude to them, because back in the 70s, that, you know, had its time and place. I don't like that now. Well, I see people in my neighborhood coming to the doors. I don't get up and answer the door. I don't even feel like telling them that I already know who Jesus is, that it's all right. It's my door. I paid for it. I don't have to touch it if I don't want to. And if they're doing good to somebody else, well, then they need to go on to the next door, you know. Go where you can do good. You're not going to get anything here because, you know. Move on down. Now, I will tell you that I haven't always been that way. A couple of times I've had to open the door just to say, "Yes, I'm a gay Christian."
Amen.
I'm a Pentecostal gay Christian. And I will say, while none of them have ever been rude to me, ever, they usually, after they hear that part, didn't stick around very much longer. They were just glad I had found a church that loved me. And I was too. And I want to tell you something, brothers and sisters. Jesus said, "I'm going to give you the Holy Spirit, But the reason I'm giving you the Holy Spirit is not so you can just dance and shout and carry on and have a good time, although there's nothing wrong with that. I want you to do that too. But that's not the real reason I'm giving it to you. It's so that you can, what? Go out and be the church. He said, I'm enduing you with this power. I'm putting all this power in you so you can go out there and be the church. Not go out there and shove Jesus down people's throats. Not go out there and try to change people's minds that if they already have faith of their own or they've already figured out what works for them, that you're there to disrupt that and change that, but just to bless them on their way, just like I expect anybody shows up at my door to bless me because I found my path. It may not have been theirs, but it sure was working for me and still is. So I don't need to go interrupt their path either if they've already worked that. But my job is to be the church. Well, how do you do that? How do you do that? I guarantee you, a lot of you have been the church this week and didn't even know it. If you checked on your next door neighbor through this storm, you were being the church. That's right. Because what's the point of being the church? That you love God and love your neighbor as you love yourself. Which is three things, not really two. It means that you got to love God, you got to love yourself, and you got to love your neighbor. Because you can't love your neighbor if you don't love yourself, evidently, according to the scriptures. So you got to love yourself. That doesn't mean you have to be selfish. It just means you have to take care of yourself so you know how to take care of others. I was so moved this week when one of our people that's been homeless came to my office first thing this week, and I was over here for a few minutes in the office, even though I wasn't feeling well. But he came over here. I wanted to come and make sure everything was settled at the church before the storm got here. And he said, here's my phone number if anybody needs me. If this storm disrupts people's homes and they need some help, call me. I'll go wherever they are. I thought, he got it. He got it not only here, he got it here. He knows what being church is. He knows what being church is. I'm going to be there for you. Sending out an email once in a while. Writing a letter to the editor once in a while in the newspaper. Sometimes it's easy for us to just do things for each other. You know, I'll look out for my family members. And I'll look out for my church community. But what about this week when your neighbor had a flat tire? Did you help them? I guarantee you if you knew how to and they needed it, you did. And if you didn't, I bet you stood there and were their cheerleader while they fixed it. Because sometimes being a cheerleader is all that somebody needs. And most of us gay boys are good at being cheerleaders. Just in case you're wondering. Maybe you cooked a little bit more today because you knew some people didn't have power. That's being the church. Maybe you knew Josephia wasn't going to be here today, and the several hats that she wears on Sunday morning, you stepped up to take care of things and make sure we have ushers and to make sure there's going to be a spoon in every bowl back there during during potluck today. Maybe sometimes we have to do some out there kind of things. You see, most of us are pretty comfortable offering someone a cup of water. Most of us are comfortable amongst ourselves. But if we're going to have to march in a parade, sometimes, well, I'm not really sure where I'm ready to get up there and march. Even though I know it might help promote people's rights. And I'm not just talking about gay pride parades either. I'm talking about wherever we see people in trouble and we reach out and we help and we become a part of a bigger community. Maybe we have to send out emails, and some of us are real good at posting on Facebook. Some of us probably overpost on Facebook. Sometimes we have to stand up in the dunamis. We have to stand up in the power of the Holy Spirit against racism and against sexism and ageism and homophobia and transphobia. And we have to stop bigotry when we see it. A few weeks ago, a friend of mine, well, an acquaintance of mine, I should say, I'm not sure we'll be friends, an acquaintance of mine who is white and Native American used the N-word in front of me. And I was like, and he's a gay person. And I'm like, I said, excuse me, I want to make sure that I heard you. I don't want you to repeat that, but did you just say the N-word in front of me? He said, yeah, I shouldn't have done that, but you know. I was like, yes, I know. I think this is totally out of my range of comfort. And we're never going to help our own cause when we're putting down others. And I'm not sure we can be acquaintances anymore. Sometimes you just got to put it out there. You just got to say. Sometimes it means severing relationships. But you've got to be in the power of the dunamis, the Holy Spirit within you, to stop those things. You say, well, I don't know how to do all of that stuff. Jesus said, but you shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you. You don't know? Ask God. The Holy Spirit will be there. The Holy Spirit will guide you. The Holy Spirit will be that force, that miraculous power, that ability, that abundance, that meaning, that might, that efficiency, that strength, that violence even that comes with the winds of change. My sisters and brothers, if your power has been out, well, guess what? You've come to the right place today because the power is on right here. Amen. As a friend of mine said this week, I want to be so full of the Spirit that if a mosquito bites me, he says, there's power in the blood. Amen. Now that's full of the Spirit. Amen. That's full of the Spirit. Comes time for us to receive our offering. Would you pray with me? God, thank you for this time that we have to give and offer some of the financial gifts you've blessed us with back to this congregation, this community of faith, and all of the many, many, many ways that it's used to reach out, not only here in this building, but outside of this building. To not only be in this building for church worship, but also to go out of this building for being the church out there. We praise you for everyone who has to give today. We ask you to multiply it over and over and over and over and let it be used for your honor and glory. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. My sisters and brothers, it comes time for us to come to the table of God, to come and receive, to come and take in the nourishment, the spiritual nourishment that does help us to go out and be the church beyond the doors of this building. Not long before the story that was told today and that I preached about today, Jesus was having a meal with his disciples, and he took the bread off the table and he blessed it and he broke it and said, this is my body that is broken for you. He took the cup and he blessed it and said, this is my blood that's poured out for you. It is the power of God in you. And as often as you come together, take these simple elements and remember me. My sisters and brothers, at Metropolitan Community Church, we have an open communion. That means you don't have to be a member of this church or any other church to come to the table of God. We believe that all of us are welcome at God's table, and God always has enough. What happens when you come up is we take the bread, dip it in the non-fermented grape juice, place it on your tongue, or if you so choose, cup your hands, and we'll place it in your hands, and you may serve yourself. There also will be prayer partners on either side of the room, and if you have a special need, they will be happy to pray with you about that. All we ask is that you come as the ushers direct you. My sisters and brothers, I hope that you've enjoyed being in worship today. As the praise team comes and gets ready to sing our closing song, I invite you to rise as you're able and join us. God, we thank you for the power of the Holy Spirit. We thank you for the dunamis that's in each one of us. We thank you, God, because you started us out and you're finishing us up in this place. And God, we ask that as we leave this place today, that we will not just have come here and had good church, but we'll go out from this place and be good church. We ask now that you will bless our time of food, fun, and fellowship this afternoon at the potluck. We ask that you will bless this food to the nourishments of our bodies and our bodies to your service. In Christ's name, amen. Amen. Shake hands and be friendly.